truth. Come on now. Waiting for change to come.
Waiting for change to come. Knowing the battle's won. For you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Sing it out. Still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me. Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah.
Just the passion and the energy and the hearts that are in this room right now this morning. God, we're coming together as a group and a body of people that support and love each other through every phase of life. No matter if we're walking through this door, we have so much hurt weighing down, or also we're walking through a season of life that's full of joy. God, we ask that you just make your presence known this morning. As we truly step into your authentic worship. God, we love you so much. And it's your name we pray. Amen. Sing along with us.
Your love is devoted, like a ring of solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of oath.
Your love is enduring through the winter rain and beyond the horizon. Mercy for today, and faithful you have been, and faithful you will be. You pledge yourself to me, and that's why I sing your praise with. Ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips, ever be, ever be on lips. You father the orphan, your kindness makes us whole. You shoulder our weakness, and your strength becomes our own. Now you're making me like you, you're clothing me in white, bringing beauty from ashes, for you will have your bride, hey, free of all her guilt, and rid of all her shame, and known by her true name, and that's
I'm one of the pastors here at Cokesbury. We are thrilled to have you. Say hey to the folks worshiping with us online. Give them a welcome. Now, I don't want the people online to miss out on what all's going on here today. They're seeing what's happening on the stage, but what they can't get, which you guys aren't getting online, is the smell today. I just want to acknowledge that, yes, it smells like a skunk in our church, okay? Can everybody just acknowledge that? There's apparently some kind of turf war going on between some skunks here in West Knoxville, and we have become the battleground for that. So thoughts and prayers accepted as we work on that this week. We're sorry if today is your first day here. We're so glad you're here, and I swear it does not normally smell like this. So give us another chance to smell better next week. No, we are so glad to see you guys. Right now, we want to welcome, if you have completed kindergarten through second grade, you can go meet with the banner at the back. If you've completed third through fourth grade, you can come meet at the banner right over here. If you have completed fifth and sixth grade, you can go meet with the orange banner over to this side. And our kids are going to Cokesbury Kids and to 56 and student ministry to learn more about what it means to follow Jesus in their daily life. So we are excited that they're doing that. If you're brand new and your kids have never gone to Cokesbury Kids, go with them. Go check out 56. Just walk with them and see what that's all about. We'd love for you guys to be a part of that. And glad you're here this morning. If you are new, stop at guest services on your way out just outside these back doors. We've got a gift for you. We'd love to meet you and see how we can connect and help you to be as comfortable here as you can. Right now, we've got some folks who are going to come up and help us take an offering. And we do that every week, not because we have to or because God makes us, but because it's an invitation from God to say, look, I don't want to do this by myself. I've invited people to be a part of the work I'm doing in this world, and we get to be a part of what God is doing. So we appreciate so much those of you who are giving online, who are doing recurring giving. If you put something in the basket, if you give at the kiosk, whatever way you're doing that, thank you, thank you. What you're doing is making a difference in this city and around the world. So let's pray together. God, we're so thankful to be in your house this morning, for a chance to worship you, to just feel like, you know, we just got to press reset for a minute, just on everything in our life, just get back to the center and be with you. God, we ask right now that you would be with this offering and that you'd bless it. Every single dollar put in, every check written, everything given online, that you would use that so that somebody new would come to know the saving power of Jesus Christ. It's in his name that we're praying. Amen.
Every day, whatever you want, not my will. Good morning. My name is Mark. I'm one of the pastors here at Cokesbury. I work with recovery, among other things. It's just good to be with you guys today. That was just a killer song. Amen. I mean, I love the drums. You got to have bass guitar. I mean, I don't really like rock and roll music in church, but this one time it was pretty good. It's pretty good. Everybody all right this morning? Good. It's my perfect weather. It's 90 degrees every day. Love that. I get on the news, I go, for the 11th day, it's been 90 days. It's like, it's perfect, man. This is perfect right here. So want to welcome you here. If it's your first time here, really good to be with you. We are going to continue our series, Origins, today. We've been into important stories in the first half of the Bible that teach us some of the basics about what it's like to be in a relationship with God. And last week, Anna started with part A of this story about Abraham and Sarah. And we're going to get into part B of that same story today. So I would recommend, if you missed last week, go check out the first half of this story and see what she was talking about. It'll give you a lot more insight into what we're going to be doing today. And so that'll be a helpful 30 minutes that you can spend. Let's pray together. Sweet Jesus, we thank you for this time in this room. And Lord, we thank you for coming today to disturb us and to speak truth into us that maybe we're not sure we want to hear. We know that your Holy Spirit will take what is difficult for us and put it into our hearts in such a way that we can really know you and know what you're trying to say to us. In your sweet name we pray, amen. So man, church is a good place to be today, this week. I think it was July the 3rd. The TV gods at DirecTV, you know, they like chucked ABC, so you can't watch ABC right now. So like at my house, this is a problem because my wife, Carol, she, I don't really know why she likes this, but she likes all these gothic shows, like back from 11-11 or I don't know when. And she goes, because she's always goes over to England all the time, I don't really care. I don't care. I think they're all sort of stupid shows. I don't like them. And I mean, then she wants to, you know, then it's like tennis. We got to have that. I'm not really that much of a fan of that. And like the thing is, when the ABC is off, like important shows are off, like The Bachelorette. Amen. So I mean, like, what do? So I think you go to church, right? You just automatically go to church when The Bachelorette is not on ABC. Amen. It's kind of like Chick-fil-A. It's like rule number two of when to go to church. So I want to talk today about, not really about that. I mean, I kind of do, but we won't. I want to talk about possession today. So when I was in, I think, junior high, my younger sister, asked me if she could borrow a spiral notebook. She had to have it for a class. She had forgotten hers. She needed to take notes, blah, blah, blah. So I give her the notebook, and I go, you know, I want it back. You know, I like when you give it back to me when you get home today. Fine, she says, fine. So I get home and I ask her for the notebook. She goes, what notebook? I'm like, the one I loaned you. Well, you gave me that notebook. I go to my mom. I go, listen, I mean, I loaned her that notebook. I didn't give it to her. She won't give it back. My mom goes, I don't really care. It's whatever it is with your sister, that's how you have six children. You decide what's important. She goes, I don't really care, right? I don't care about your notebook. It's a notebook. Get another one. The whole thing is your problem, you know. So I took my case to my dad. When he got home from work, my dad goes, well, there's two things here. Item number one, you loaned your notebook to your sister. Your sister, because she's a girl, is smarter, she's craftier, she's more devious, and she believes that she owns the world. And she goes, he goes, you should have never given her something you weren't giving away. That's number one. Number two, don't ever loan anything to anybody in your family that you actually think is a loan. Amen. If you're going to give somebody in your family something, it's theirs. That's how they're going to do it. That's like possession. And today, today we have this story that Anna got the first half of going about you know, she was talking to you about Abraham and Sarah and this miracle child, Isaac. You know, they were 170 years old or whatever they were, and God comes to them and says, you're going to have this child. This child is going to represent this big nation that I'm going to grow, and you're going to be like the line holder. You're going to be the lineage of this. And they don't, you know, I don't know why they didn't. I don't know why they didn't at their age, but they somehow had a hard time believing God when God said they were going to have this baby and they were 100 or whatever they were. And they went through, as you learned last week, if you watched it, if you didn't, go back and watch, all kind of gyrations to avoid what God was trying to do with them. All kind of gyrations to basically avoid God's promise. Because they didn't, like us, they really didn't believe God. I mean, you know, like, they really didn't believe that God could pull that off. And so he does, and we pick up the story at that place. So it goes, Genesis 22, sometime later, God tests Abraham. Now remember, by now they have Isaac. He's a cute little kid. He can talk. They love him, man. They love him. He is their treasured child, right? He is priceless to them. They know that God made all that happen, but now, they think he's theirs. Wouldn't you? I mean, they changed his diapers or whatever the equivalent of diaper was back in Bible land. I don't know. If ABC was on, I could probably find that out, like in some kind of show. But since it's not, now I have to guess. But they changed his diapers. They fed him. They took care of him. They raised him. They drove him to preschool. They did all the stuff you do. He was theirs, right? He was theirs. They had earned that possession. And so now we get God involved. God comes to Abraham to test him. He says, here I am, Abraham says. Here's the thing about God. God loves you so much this morning that he wants to lay claim to you. Not parts of you, all of you. Like, we're good with God laying claim to parts of our lives, right, where we don't really know how to fix it, aren't we? Like, if we get to the point where we've tried everything we can try, then we're good with praying or talking to God. And we basically take stuff in our life when it looks completely hopeless to us, and we go, whoom, here, God. I don't know what to do with this. You fix it. I mean, you're my last shot. It's like, do you notice that for us spiritually, God's rarely our first shot, right? When it comes to our prayers and stuff and the way we talk to God, God's really rarely our first shot where we're gonna go to God right away with some part of our life. It's gotta be troubled, thoroughly messed up, and really jacked up usually for us to ask God to get involved. God loves you so much that he wants to lay claim to every part of you. And the part he really wants to lay claim to in your life is your heart. You know, like, we're okay with God having, you know, some kind of an influence over our thoughts. As long as God's plan agrees with ours, we're okay with God having some kind of a influence over our futures, you know, our plans and our futures. But this thing with God laying claim to our hearts, man, we're not always oh so proud of our hearts. We're not always all so proud of what goes on in there. And God wants to lay claim to that because he knows that's where the core of us is, because that's how he made us. And so he wants to lay claim to Abraham. And how is he gonna do that? How's he gonna do that with Abraham and Sarah? Well, here's how he's gonna do it. He's gonna begin to challenge what they think their prized possession is. And in their case, it's Isaac. Is it true that nothing that we believe we possess can be actually holy? Like, if I own it, can it actually be holy? Adam and Eve, you know, God says, look, I'm giving you this garden, everything in here, it's incredible, incredible. Everything you could ever need is in this garden. I want you to, ready? Take care of it. I want you to cause it to prosper. I want you to do good things with it. I want you to be fed by it, nurtured, all of that. But he's talking about them taking care of what is God's. He never said to them, I'm giving you the keys to the car and now it's going to be your car. He said, I'm giving you the keys to my car and I'm going to give you permission to drive it. Well, in order to lay claim to Abraham, in order to lay claim to Sarah, he was going to need to talk to them about their prized possession, about Isaac. And that's what he's in the middle of doing in this story. God says, take your son, your only son, who you love, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah. It says, sacrifice him there as a burnt offering. On a mountain, I will show you. Here's the thing about us. The longer we believe we possess stuff in our lives, the longer we believe we possess our jobs, we possess our wealth, we possess our marriages, we possess our friendships, we possess our skills and abilities, we possess our children, the longer we believe that we possess stuff, the longer we're going to be afraid of losing what we possess. Amen? If I believe I possess something, I'm always gonna be afraid of losing it. And I'm always gonna be on the run and I'm always gonna be defensive. And right now, you've got this prized possession of Adam, of Abraham's, this prized possession of Sarah's, and God is gonna challenge their belief that they possess Isaac, right? He's gonna challenge their belief of possession, because that is how God's gonna lay claim to the fear of losing something that is in their hearts. Early next morning, Abraham got up, loaded his donkey. He took with him two of his servants and his son Isaac. When he had cut enough wood for the burnt offering, he set out for the place that God told him about. Abraham somehow knows that God is trying to get inside of him. And Abraham has this capacity. It's called willingness. Willingness is the preparation for freedom. Like, if I'm not willing, I'm not free. It doesn't matter what I'm talking about. If you right now, you're in the middle of a relationship, you have it with your son or daughter or your wife or your friend, or it's not a relationship, it's something else in your life, and it seems like it's starting to spin out of control and you're really not sure what to do. And if I came to you, or God came to you, and God said, I wanna lay claim to your heart, and in order to lay claim to your heart, I wanna lay claim to the biggest fears in your life, and the biggest fear that I know of you have right now is your husband. Are you gonna give me possession of your marriage? Are you willing to give me possession of your marriage? And now you're gonna go, I need you, God, I need you to help me with him and help him to see A, B, C, D, E, F, and G. And if you'll help me to get him squared away, well, see, our marriage will be good. And the thing is, I'll give you all the glory for that. I'll tell everybody about how you helped me. Or it's her, God. I just need you to get into her and work on her heart and get her kind of squared away, because I just need these few things. Can you convince her of these three things, God? I'll get it down to three. I got a list of 30 because we've been married a while, but what if it was just three? Three, I got three on my list. I'll put three into you and see if you can make it happen. Can you do that? And God's gonna go, can I? Yeah, I can do that. Am I? Nope. I wanna know if you'll give me your whole marriage. Not just a list about your spouse, your whole marriage. Will you give it all to me? Will you be willing to let me do anything I need to do in order to create a marriage that is loving, loving of each other, that is secure, and that is honoring of me? Will you let me do anything as the slate clean where I can do anything I want to do? I don't care if it's a relationship or anything else in your life where something is really a struggle for you. That question's eventually going to get there with God, isn't it? And the thing is going to be, you got to, you know, you're kind of on the spot. You're going to go, well, I'm not really that willing. But see, willingness is always a preparation for freedom. And you're not going to have freedom until you have that kind of willingness. And that's where Abraham's walking now with God. He's walking with his son. He's walking with a couple of servants. And his willingness is there. Because what has happened? Along the way, he's seen God do stuff that he and Sarah could never do. He's seen God do the impossible. He's seen God do the unthinkable. He's seen God do what he doesn't even really want to talk to people about, because if he told them, they really wouldn't believe it. Where did that, you know, can you imagine Abraham and Sarah? Where did that kid show up from? Well, I mean, they're 100 years old. He's our son. Oh, well, I mean, like, did you adopt him? Well, no, I mean, like, she had him. They're like, God, those people need to be somewhere, man. They should not be out in public on their own. They think they had that baby. Bunch of psychos. I mean, they don't have it together. That's where they are. And then Abraham, he's like, well, I know what God did. And now I'm going to walk with God. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place God was talking about in the distance. He said to his servants, stay here with the donkey while I and the boy go over there. Here's the part. We will worship and then we will come back to you, he tells his servants. Man, oh man, this is a big, huge deal. We are going to worship. So you got Abraham sitting there being directly challenged by God to give up the thing that's most important to him, his son, knowing he's going on this march with God up this mountain where his son is going to be sacrificed. And Abraham goes, and right here, we're going to worship. Let me just ask you, is it true that when life is not going the way you thought you think it ought to go, is it true that the first thing you think about is worship? Like in most cases, in most churches, if you do my job and you don't see somebody at church for a few weeks, you normally don't think their life is going great. Amen? You normally don't go, you know, I haven't seen Johnny and Janie, you know, for 3, 6 weeks, 5 weeks, whatever. They're just having a great life. Nope. You're going to go, they're not at worship. I wonder what's going on. When we get in the middle of adversity, we turn over one of the best places in our life for some healing, which is worship in the fellowship, and we give that away. We just give it away to the enemy. I'll stay home. Well, I'm feeling like crap. I'll just stay home. I'll just let the enemy speak to me by himself. I'll give him free reign over my emotions, my heart, my thoughts, my life, because you know what? I'm not going to worship where God's people are sitting there. I'm not going to worship where there's believers. I'm not going to worship where I can hear about Jesus. I'm not going to worship where I can have God lay claim to my life and my pain. I'm going to go when I can wear my Easter Sunday hat and I feel all good about stuff. Like, man, it just won't work like that. Worship happens at the weirdest places in your life you can imagine. And I'm not just talking about having to come to church at Cokesbury on Sunday. I'm talking about worship that happens at your house, in your car, at your office, with your friends, on a walk. I don't care where it is. Worship has got to happen because it connects you to the lifeblood of Jesus and to hope and to peace and to the conviction that God is on your side. And if you don't do that, the enemy will convince you that God is not on your side. And in 6 weeks, it'll become 6 months. You'll feel very estranged, and now all of a sudden, God will be your enemy, and now all of a sudden, you won't want to walk anywhere with him, and now you'll get sicker. We will worship you. We will worship, he says, and then we'll come back to you. Like on Thursday night at Recovery, I mean, like, it's just tough to convince people to come to worship when they're in the middle of, you know, they're in the middle of relapse, they're in the middle of all kinds of pain, life starts to go sideways. What do? Opt out. Walk to the front door, man. I haven't seen you in a while. I go, what happened to you? Well, you know, I had some trouble. Some of the day told me they had a bump. I'm like, what is a bump? Well, this is what happened to me. I'm like, and when that was happening to you, why didn't you come here, man? This place is full of bumps. Why didn't you come here on Thursday? We're like the bump crowd. Everyone in there's got bumps. We're not like gonna be, oh my God, I can't believe that guy's walking in here. I mean, look, he's got some issues. Like, everybody here's got that going on. That's what church ought to be on Sunday. Worship should be places that are tough, not places that are oh so glorious. I mean, worship's got to be in unexpected places. Abraham took the wood, it says, for the burnt offering, placed it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. He himself. That's willingness. That's realizing I love Isaac. He's my treasure, but he's not mine. As the two of them went on together, Isaac spoke up and said to his father, Abraham, father. Yes, my son, Abraham replied. The fire and the wood are here, he said, but where's the lamb for the sacrifice, for the burnt offering? So there they are, top of the mountain, altar, fire. He's got the fire starter, he's got the wood. Here's the thing. When you lay down the beloved in your life, you will need to take your hands off of that beloved. Well, what is your beloved? Well, your beloved, it may be a person, but our beloved is anything that we would say we just really think we cannot, or anyone, we think we cannot live without. We just can't live without them. We can't live without that. That's our beloved. You may call that God, a God in your life. It may be a competitive God. We all have those. It may be, you may call that an idol. We have those. Your beloved is anything that you believe you simply cannot live without. And the pressing thing with Abraham and God is God going, can it just be you and me, Abraham? Can it just be you and me? What if it's not Isaac? What if it's just you and me? Have you walked with me long enough to where you realize that if it's just gonna be you and me, it's gonna be good. And I'm gonna take care of you. And that you and me can be okay. Can it just be you and me? And so there they are up there at the altar. Abraham says to his son, God will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son. And the two of them went on together. They kept walking. They stopped thinking. And they took God's hand. When you're in trouble, keep walking. Stop thinking. And take God's hand. Keep walking, stop thinking, take God's hand. When they reached the place that God had told him about, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar, his beloved, on top of the wood. He reached out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. Here's the thing. When you get to that point and your beloved is on the altar and you're not sure what's going to happen next, not only do you got to take your hands off of your beloved, but you got to realize right then and there that, and you're not going to like this, that powerlessness does not have an escape plan. Amen? Powerlessness doesn't have an escape plan. That's where it's just going to be God. And you're going to be standing there completely vulnerable. And that right there is what true freedom looks like. But an angel of the Lord called out to him from heaven, Abraham, Abraham, here I am, he replied. Do not lay a hand on the boy, he said. Do not do anything to him, because I now know that you fear God, because you have not withheld from me your son, your beloved, your only son. Abraham looked up and there in a thicket saw a ram caught by its horns. He went over and took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. Here's the thing. Do you not see in this story right there, Jesus all over the place? The lamb in the thicket is Jesus. The blood that's about to be shed is the blood of Jesus. Jesus always, always stands in our place. Amen. Always lays down his life for us. Always. When you're having a horrible day, you got to get up and you got to say to yourself, I know I'm worth something because Jesus stood in my place. Jesus sacrificed his blood for me. Jesus offered up his life for me. He became the ram. He became the offering for me. Jesus is always the sacrifice that brings life at all times and in all places. So it says, Abraham called that place, the Lord will provide. And to this day it is said, on a mountain of the Lord, it will be provided. Man, the question here for all of us is, do we realize that in order to be completely free, we're going to have to take stuff that we think is beloved to us and take it up a mountain and put it on an altar and then get ready to let it completely go and take our hands off of it and experience that unbelievably unnerving feeling of being completely powerless? Do we realize that that's going to happen in our lives? Pick the most important thing you got going on right now that you're having the most trouble on. Tell me you don't have a grip on it. I have a friend, John Frazier. Frazier is his nickname. So he's the head golf pro at Sea Pines, which is a golf course on Hilton Head. So Frazier, his grandfather, was the developer of this Sea Pines resort. And Frazier always goes, yeah, well, the reason that I'm the golf pro is because they realized soon in my life that I didn't have that kind of an ability as a businessman, and I didn't have that... I didn't really have that ability as a developer, so they just told me, listen, Frazier, just go play with the guests. So I go, so I ended up over at the golf course. And now he's a golf pro, and he goes, let me tell you the most difficult thing about being a golf pro. He goes, try to tell somebody anything about their swing. He goes, when you tell a golfer about their swing, every golfer thinks they're a scratch golfer. And you're sitting there as the pro, they're paying you $300 an hour or whatever it is. And he goes, I'm sitting there going, you got to loosen your grip, man. You got a grip on this club like you're going to beat somebody with it. What's the deal? I mean, I don't play golf. But he's like, you know, you got to let it go. You got to let the club swing for itself. You got to give the club its own freedom. You got to be able to let go. He goes, 9 out of 10 people can't pull that off. Because they have fear that if they let the club do what it's going to do, guess what? They will not be in control. And he goes, if you let the club do what it's supposed to do, the club will be in control. You'll be a better golfer. No one wants to do it. We actually believe in this room this morning that we know better than God. At the top of that mountain, there was that sign or whatever, said, God will provide. How many places right now this morning would you say in your life the sign actually reads, I will provide. I will provide. I'm going to be the one to do it. I'm going to be the one to be in charge. I'm going to be the one to get it done. I'm going to be the one to fix it. I'm going to be the one to get it right. And how many places in your life have the sign that says God will provide? Because the only places in your life or mine where we're really gonna have freedom is when that other sign, God will provide, is sitting there. And that's what's happening. You know, we met a woman this week, Kylie. She's gonna come up now with Anna and I, and she's gonna renew this morning her relationship with Jesus with all of us. And so We're going to dip her in this water and we're going to do exactly that. So give it up for her, would ya? So Kylie, I want to ask you, do you reject the devil and all his empty promises today? And do you receive Jesus today as your Lord and Savior? We want you to remember the day that you were baptized. And we're going to remember that by bringing you into the waters of Jesus. The day you were baptized, you were sealed with the cross of Jesus and marked with the power of the Holy Spirit. And on that day, you were set free. And on this day, you're going to reclaim that freedom and walk as a free woman. In Jesus' sweet name, amen.
Is that lives get changed in this very room. And there's a lot of people outside these doors that have no idea that that goes on. So please invite them. We want to meet them. We want them to get to experience what we get to celebrate every single week here. So you guys have a great rest of your Sunday. We'll see you next week. Goodbye.